some comments our great mate and panellist Joe made on the show recently got a lot of you at home fired up. This is what Joe said after a magistrate warned that returning soldiers that violent crimes shouldn't be unduly blamed on post-traumatic stress disorder. Let's have a listen.
I have the utmost respect for our defence forces, of course, but people need to understand that when they sign up, and it's the same with the police, who I also have a huge amount of respect for, but you can't just come back and say, be so surprised by what you see over there and blame everything on a medical condition. Sometimes people just do bad things because they have bad impulse control and bad anger problems, and it's not the result of post-traumatic stress disorder, and you can't blame everything on the world.
OK, those comments caused a storm on our social media sites, so we're revisiting the issue today. We have soldier and PTSD sufferer Rob Pickersgill in Canberra, and here on the panel we have psychologist Professor Richard Bryant. Welcome, gentlemen. Great to have you part of our show. Joe, let's start with you.
Yes.
Do you regret the comments?
I certainly regret the way... What I was trying to say was that PTSD should not be used as an excuse for violent crime. I have very low tolerance for people using any mental illness, quite frankly, as an excuse for violent crime. I have a very low tolerance for violent crime. And most of the feedback I got actually agreed with me on that from PTSD sufferers and other vets. I said, no, it shouldn't be used as an excuse. What I really do regret, and I'm very sorry for, is that some people who saw the comments thought I was talking about all PTSD sufferers generally, which is a huge number of people, and that was certainly not what I was doing. That is not who I was referring to. I was referring specifically to the very small minority who say PTSD made me do this, which I genuinely believe is an insult and does a grave disservice to the vast majority of PTSD sufferers who are fine, law-abiding citizens who deal with their demons and do not take it out by violently abusing those close to them or innocent strangers.
All right, let's hear from Rob in Canberra. Rob, you served in Rwanda, East Timor and Iraq. What got you so incensed, I suppose, by what Joe said?
Well, it wasn't necessarily me being incensed. It was really to address some of the stigmas attached there. In particular, Joe's comments about that you need to be tough to be a soldier, and I agree. However, that's the problem with us, that sometimes we're too tough to recognise that, first of all, that we need help, and secondly, that we even have symptoms of PTSD, and it's often too late when we find out that we do have it. Therefore, some of these violent acts do come about, which I totally disagree with as well. But the idea is to recognise those symptoms early and not fall into the area where you're going to commit a violent act.
It's such a blanket disorder. What sort of symptoms, I suppose, present when you are suffering PTSD? What have you gone through?
Okay, from my experience, I actually ignored it for 16 years. Wow. It came to a head when I physically collapsed one day. I thought I had medical conditions and spent about 12 months worth of tests to finally be told that it was post-traumatic stress. Looking back over that period of time, I can see that I had an increased level of anxiety. I had increased anger issues, which I was suppressing. And I couldn't interact with people the way that I actually physically interacted with them before I'd experienced these experiences. So all them come to a head, and I basically just couldn't cope with them any longer.
Rob, good on you for talking about your experiences, because as you say, there's this expectation that men are meant to be tough and that you need to sort of just get on with it and get through it. Do you think you were given enough support once you returned from active duty?
Okay, Jessica, I'm actually glad that you raised that one, because we have got better over the years as a defence force, and I do note that. However, we spend a lot of time training for war and the expectations how we react to violent acts, but we do not train to come home. And this is the big issue, that we need to be prepared to come back to an environment where we're no longer on a heightened level of awareness and that we don't need that to survive anymore. And we need to be able to integrate back into society effectively.
Rob, is it widespread among other veterans, among the men and women that you know that you've fought with?
Yes, it is. And the idea is, and what I encourage as well with my friends, is to don't go alone, to check on your mates and ask, are you okay? Because the worst they can say is, yes, go away. The worst that can happen. They can come back and say, listen, mate, I'm glad you asked. I need some help.
All right, we might go to Professor Richard Bryant now. Professor, I mean, how can soldiers best be treated? And actually, let's start with this first. I mean, Ida as well said in the discussion that perhaps PTSD is used as an excuse by returning soldiers. I mean, what are your thoughts on that?
Well, if we're talking about violence and anger, I mean, I think it's not a matter of blame. I think that's the wrong word. Because blame suggests, you know, that it's a scapegoat. And I think there's good evidence that it's not. I mean, I'd actually disagree with you. I think you're disagreeing with yourself, Joe, about what you said earlier.
About what, sorry? You just
about the fact that the violence and the anger that people, vets with PTSD, you know, are blaming it on the PTSD and are blaming it on their service. But
well, this is what a judge, just to put it in context, so I don't want to interrupt, but this is what a judge in Townsville said after, I think, the fifth case, including a soldier who attacked a police officer and dragged him down the street, another soldier who bashed four of his comrades, and again, this most recent one, a guy who said he had PTSD after, I think it was a fall, and said that this was his excuse for punching someone.
But it sounds like they hadn't.
Sorry.
I think it's worth listening to a really important study that came out of the UK recently that actually did a really nice analysis of troops coming back from the Middle East recently. And they linked it all with legal records, criminal records. And they really found that those who'd gone to combat and had served, the rates of violent conviction really spiked. Mm. And this is consistent with what a lot we know about PTSD. I mean, the nature of the condition is it creates a lot of arousal, makes your impulse control a lot poorer, and it's part of the cost of war. Mm. And I think it's not a matter of blaming them, it's a matter of how do we actually bring in programs that actually assist veterans, not just veterans, but victims of crime, police, I mean, people with PTSD. We know that anger is a very common problem. Mm. How do we actually treat it to actually assist them adjust better?
Professor, one of the questions that Ida was asking was, during the discussion as well, was that during World War I and II, a lot of people were coming back and they didn't suffer PTSD.
They didn't talk about it.
Is it a new thing? And they weren't hitting people and that type of thing. They were just kind of, you know, dealing with it.
That's a really interesting question. If you actually go back to the history and read the early works, I mean, they called it shell shock back then.
Yeah.
It was huge. I mean, as you know, trench warfare in World War I was like the worst warfare we've known in recent times. It was horrendous what people put up with. The rates of PTSD, that even though it wasn't called that then, was massive. We know it was a major, major problem. So it's not a new thing. We just call it something different now.
And can I just, because I have obviously been looking into this since more. I've thought about it a lot in the past, but the figures are just staggering. We are looking at... There was a report in the Herald Sun based on ADF figures very late last year that estimated that the suicide rate among ex-servicemen and women, we don't know how much of it was related to combat, but suicides and suspected suicides was 85 since our operations began most recently in the Middle East, so since about, you know, 2002, thereabouts. The number of casualties in the number of deaths caused in combat over there is about 40. So we have more than twice as many soldiers killing themselves, taking their own lives, as we do enemy combatants taking soldiers' lives. Surely that says that something is very, very wrong, either with the way we screen our troops, we prepare our troops, the way we deploy our troops. Some people have said that the quickness, the speed with which we can deploy troops into enemy ground, so it's one minute you're completely safe, the next minute you're behind enemy lines, that is a problem, the speed with which they rotate through. Some people have said that that defence ads promote, you know, education, and it's a great way to pay your way through uni, and said, but they don't talk about the war and what you'll experience. What is the problem here? Why are these rates so high? I mean, in 3 years alone, 780 soldiers were found to have had PTSD symptoms. And again, this compares to over the last 10 or 12 years, 282 casualties of, you know, physical casualties, people who were wounded otherwise. So why is it so high?
War and being in defence forces is stressful. You look at the rates in police, in fire, ambulance. I mean, the rates are much higher. It's a cost of the job. And, you know, defence recognises that, police recognises that. So we're aware that it's something that is specially done. I do a lot of work with the Australian Defence Force, and I'd have to say, and I agree with Rob, that years gone by, it didn't do the greatest job. But because of the Middle East deployments, etc., they have poured enormous resources. And I think what they're now doing in terms of surveying, monitoring, intervening, I mean, there's actually very, very good resources being available. They're aware they're not good enough, but in terms of the rates that they actually are having to deal with of PTSD and other mental health problems, they're doing a pretty good job.
Are we looking at a situation where PTSD is almost becoming the mean? If you go into war, you're going to get post-traumatic stress disorder, or you're very likely to, because war is traumatic, war is stressful.
Absolutely not. One thing we know from so much research around the world is that most of us are resilient.
Yeah.
And you look at rape survivors, even refugees and torture survivors. I mean, the rates are much higher in those groups, but the majority of people are actually resilient. And we must keep that in mind. In the Defence Force, overall, a huge census was done of the entire Defence Force. 8% had PTSD, and that actually had nothing to do with deployment.
No.
Well, listen, Professor, we could talk about this all day, but we have to leave it there. Thank you very much for coming in on our panel, and a big thank you as well to Army veteran Robert Pickersgill. It was great to get your insights.
Thanks very much.
Yeah.